how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. My chains are gone,
Church this morning. I hope you all will enjoy the sermon. We have Pastor Louise Sloan Goben. If I could get it out, sometimes I just have trouble with that. Tuesday is Flag Day. Wednesday we are having Maranatha again. Yay! See Lori Harden if you'd like to go. And then on June 20th we have the congregational meeting after the worship, which will be very important, and it's also Father's Day. Now, if you will join me in the call to worship. It is good to give thanks to the Lord.
To sing praises to your name.
To declare your steadfast love in the morning.
And your faithfulness in the night.
For you, O Lord, make me glad by your work. At the works of your hands, I sing for joy.
Thank you. May the peace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Amen. Neil's here. So God, we gather this morning for worship. We gather to celebrate your love. We gather to celebrate your grace. We gather as your people, sons and daughters of your love, brothers and sisters alive in your grace. And so as we are here, we ask that you would just fill us with your Spirit. We ask that you bless us, that our hearts may be filled always, God, with the zeal to celebrate your great love. And we pray this in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Glory be to the Father.
Good morning. The scripture this morning is from the book of Mark, chapter 4, verses 26 through 34. He also said, "The kingdom of God is as if someone would scatter seed on the ground and would sleep and rise night and day, and the seed would sprout and grow. He does not know how. The earth produces of itself first the stalk, then the head, then the full grain in the head. But when the grain is ripe, at once he goes in with his sickle, because the harvest has come." He also said, "With what can we compare the kingdom of God, or what parable will we use for it? It is like a mustard seed, which, when sown upon the ground, is the smallest of all the seeds on earth. Yet when it is sown, it grows up and becomes the greatest of all shrubs and puts forth large branches, so that the birds of the air can make nests in its shade." With many such parables, he spoke the word to them, as they were able to hear it. He did not speak to them except in parables, but he explained everything in private to his disciples. May the Lord add his blessing to this reading.
Yeah, you guys are doing it, okay? Or sometimes we do grass seed in
I'm next. Prayers of the people.
And to celebrate each day the love that you have given to us.
Thank you, Casey. Hi, Nia. I'm so glad you don't mind Neil being in worship. Because there are some folks that find that very distracting, I know. So it's interesting how things dovetail. If there's something that I'm thinking about or something that's on my mind or whatever, and then I'll hear or notice an article in the newspaper or a story on the TV or whatever it is that somehow connects the dots for me. And I was thinking about the scripture for today and these two parables, which are pretty well known to most of us in the church, certainly the mustard seed. That's just standard fare for all of us. But this other one, which may be not quite as well known, about the kingdom of God being like someone who would scatter seed and they go to sleep at night and wake up in the morning, go to sleep at night and wake up in the morning, and the next thing you know, stuff's growing. You don't know how it works, you just trust that it's going to work. And the kingdom of God is that way. I was driving, and on the radio, NPR, listening to an interview, and I came in partway through the interview, so of course I had to buy the book. After hearing this author interviewed. But I learned a great deal about the secret life of trees and other plants as I listened to this interview and then read the book. Trees, ferns, mushrooms, fungi, is that how you pronounce it? Fungus, plural? Not something that I ever thought I would be terribly interested in. I'm not a botanist. I like the forest. I like being in the mountains. But I'm not terribly interested in those sorts of things. And yet, the stories that this author, Suzanne Simran was her name, and she wrote a book called Finding the Mother Tree. It was fascinating. And I learned an amazing amount about forestry and about trees, and about systems. Simran is the daughter of, and the granddaughter of, loggers. She grew up in a family of loggers in British Columbia, in Canada. And they lived, her family, in these deep, primitive forests, and they lived a difficult life, a challenging life. That's what they chose for themselves and their family. And she, as a child, learned then to love trees. And she learned to get in and watch the bugs crawling in and out of pine needles that were on the ground and enjoying the rich, loamy soil that was underneath it. And as a kid, she would lay and she would dig and she would look and she would notice. And these things that she began to notice as a child later then informed what she began to learn as she studied science in school. Eventually, she came to also work for a logging firm, and then she learned to work for the National Park Service up in Canada, and she became more of a preservationist of forests and of trees rather than one who was concerned about the logging interests. Not that she objected to it, but to understand how to do logging responsibly, for lack of a better way to put it. And what she describes in this book, as she observed, is that forests are way more than just a collection of trees. Trees, she learned, live in a web of interdependence. They need one another. They are linked by a system of underground channels, for lack of a better way to put it. That literally trees, the fungus, the ferns, all of the critters that live down in the soil beneath the stuff that you and I see with our eyes. There's like this web of interconnectedness that just flows through everything. And if you dig down just a little bit and begin to pull out even a mushroom, they're like little threads and they might even look like just like roots. And yet those little threads run underneath the ground everywhere in this network, comprising basically a whole system of these trees and these plants communicating with one another. Simran refers to this as tree-to-tree communication. They do this by relaying information through this network of underground fungus. And it runs all throughout the forest floor, connecting the trees. Simran was able to map some of these networks in the forest as she studied them. She said it's kind of like the neurons in the human body that are small. You can't see them except under a microscope. And yet we have these little synapses that connect with one another that help us to move, that help us to talk, that help us to do all of the things our body needs to do in order to function. Simran also identified what she calls mother trees. And these are the biggest, the largest trees in the forest, the most majestic of the pines that you would see in these alpine forests. And they stand as the hub for this communication. That these large, these massive trees that are the ones that can soak up the sunshine and have deep roots to pull in the water and the nutrients for the soil and then send out these currents, these signals to all of the other trees. The mother trees nurture everything from the saplings and the tiniest of trees to the more mature trees as well. The mother trees function in much the same way as a parent would to their children. They provide everything that the trees need to function and to grow and to survive, sometimes in very harsh climates. She writes, "The forest is wired for wisdom. Trees are wired for sentience and for healing. If there's a tree that is stressed or a tree that is struggling, the more nutrients, more water will be directed toward that tree. And when trees are harvested or clear-cut by foresting, that even planting new trees is not necessarily helpful for the forest because those connections have not been made. Those synapses have not been completed. Because often, some of the first trees to go are those mother trees, the big ones, the majestic ones, because there's just more wood in them than there are in the smaller trees. All of life is connected, whether we see it or not. So much happens outside of our ordinary perception. And perhaps this network of fungi are small and they live buried beneath the pine forests. We don't see them. We may not even know they exist. Just like our own neural networks are buried deep within our bodies, we don't see them with our eyes. But if they don't work right, we know we're in serious trouble. As the saying goes, sometimes there are some things that are just out of sight and out of mind. So going back to today's gospel lesson, and we have these two parables, one right after the other, that are so familiar. The sower scatters the seed, and he trusts that it's going to grow. But everything that happens, happens underground in secret. And Mark uses that word, secret. So you don't see what's happening until the sprouts come up. And once they do, you trust what's going to happen. They grow. And when the harvest time is right and ready, then you harvest what it is that you've planted. You rely on that. You count on that. All that invisible stuff that happens underground. And the mustard seed, Jesus said. The kingdom of God is like a mustard seed. It's this little tiny seed. We all know how big a mustard seed is. And yet when it grows, it produces shrubs that are large enough for birds to build their nests in and to receive shade from these bushes, from these shrubs. And they propagate themselves. You don't have to keep planting mustard seeds. Matter of fact, if anybody's ever planted mustard, you know it's hard to control it once it gets going. But Jesus says, the kingdom of God is just like that. You see, the kingdom is here. It's kind of like it's buried in a place that you can't see it too well. But if you open your eyes, you can see what it does. You can see how it happens. You can understand the way it works. The theme of the kingdom of God is brought up over and over and over again in the Gospel of Mark. This passage is so very Markan, for lack of a better way to put it. Mark refers, and it's the shortest of the Gospels, right? Mark is the shortest of the four Gospels. And yet, Jesus refers 17 times to the kingdom of God in this Gospel. The other thing Mark does over and over again in the telling of the Gospel story is to reiterate. Jesus keeps saying, shh, don't tell anybody. There's all these secrets going on in the Gospel of Mark. Have you ever noticed that? Jesus heals somebody and then he says, but don't tell anybody. Don't tell anybody what happened. Why not? Why not shout it from the rooftops? Well, sometimes you can do that. Doesn't mean people are going to believe you. They have to see it for themselves. They have to come to their own personal understanding of what the kingdom of God means, or of what healing means, or of what life means, or what grace means, or what love means, what God means, what faith is in their own lives and their own living. Through my years of ministry, I have had many opportunities to sit down one-on-one with folks at the church who have said, I don't get it. I have prayed and prayed and prayed. Why doesn't God answer my prayers? Is it something I'm doing wrong? Do I not have enough faith? That somewhere along the way they come to an understanding that they must not be praying right if their prayers are not answered. I give up. God doesn't care about me. God doesn't answer my prayers. What am I doing wrong? And I've come to understand it's not about God not hearing our prayers or not answering our prayers. Heaven knows there have been times I've been disappointed when God didn't answer prayers in the way I thought they should have been answered or the way I hoped they should have been answered. And yet, over time, I have come so deeply to trust in the power of that network that you can't see, that connection to God that you can't just flip a switch on and say, okay, let's go. That's not how it works. It's more subtle than that. It's much more difficult to perceive unless, as Jesus says, you have eyes to see it and ears to hear it. And sometimes in prayer, we simply have to take a long view. Things don't always happen automatically. That's not how the kingdom of God works. It's present all around us, all of the time. And we have to trust that when we plant seeds with our prayers, they will come to fruition, perhaps in ways we don't ever anticipate. This is something Galen and I have learned over and over again when it comes to that kid back there, right? He's unique. And he can't tell us what he wants or what he needs except by his own version of sign languages and words. 10 or 12 years ago, I can't remember exactly how long ago it was now, he was complaining about being uncomfortable about something, and he does have the sign for hurt, and he would just kind of point to himself. And we were trying to figure out what was hurting. And we took him to doctors trying to diagnose, maybe it's a hernia. Maybe it's a urinary tract infection. Maybe it's a, I don't know. We tried all kinds of theories about what this might be. Well, that summer we traveled, the three of us, to Nashville for the General Assembly of the Christian Church. And whatever day we arrived, the next day, Neil began once again really complaining, whatever this was that was hurting him. That afternoon, we were getting him out of the shower, and when he stepped out over the tub and put his full weight on one leg, he screamed. And he began trembling and crying, and the tears were just coming down his face. He was in pain. There was no doubt about it. We did our best quickly to get him dressed, dried off, dressed, got him in his wheelchair, went down to the concierge desk and said, "Where's the closest emergency room? We need to get this boy to a doctor." And they said, "We will call you a cab, go on out to the valet service," and we did. And the courtesy van driver was out there. And the courtesy van driver said, "What's going on? What do you need?" "Well, we need to get him to the emergency room," and they told us inside that Baptist Hospital was the closest one. He goes, "I've got a better idea. Let's put you in the courtesy van. I'm taking you to Vanderbilt University Medical Center because they have a children's department there, and they will be able to help you." And so we loaded in the courtesy van. He took us up there, drove us in. He got out of the van really quickly, ran into the emergency room door, and pretty soon, nurses were hustling out with wheelchairs. They were ready to take him in, and it's like, "How did you do that? How did you know where to go?" And he told us that recently his daughter had been diagnosed with a childhood cancer, and they'd spent a heck of a lot of time at the emergency room at Vanderbilt University Children's Hospital. He knew the doctors, he knew the nurses, he just knew how everything worked. They took Neil in. He was diagnosed. It was a hip problem. It was a bone problem. He had surgery the next morning, and the next morning, we were checked out of the hospital. That fast. And we were back at General Assembly. And some folks didn't even miss us. How do you like them apples? They thought we were vacationing for a day. There were others who knew where we were. How did that happen? How did all of those connections, that it was that van driver that we met at the door, that knew the details with regard to Vanderbilt University Children's Hospital? How did that work? I didn't know how to pray. I didn't pray. I'll be honest, except when we were done, all I could pray was thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you. I still do. That is the first prayer I go to always. Thank you. Thank you, God, for everything, for the connections that we have with one another, because these are the connections that connect our hearts to each other, for the connections of roots and of fungus in the soil that breathe life and nutrients into the trees and the plants, that support the birds and the wildlife, that supports us, that oxygenates everything, that helps us all to connect. Jesus says, that's the kingdom of God, folks. It's not something that's gonna happen someday. It's here, if you pay attention. It's already in secret. If you have eyes to see and ears to hear, you will come to know the reality of the kingdom that is already in our midst. Nurture it. Pay attention to it. Plant more seeds so it will just continue to grow and to grow and to grow. It's like a web. It's like a network. Yeah, even a fungus under the ground. But all of life is a give and take of love. And of hope, and of joy, and of peace, and all of those fruits of the Spirit that we choose to share with one another. We are called to notice it and then to cultivate it. God's grace, and to trust its presence always in our lives. And this is the secret that Jesus was pointing to over and over and over again. So let's go out and live it. Let's go out and trust that love, that hope, that peace, and to live in the reality of the mutual love between us and between God and between this whole sentient world that God has created. Because you know what? That's good news. That's real good news. Amen and amen.
Shed as blood.
are accustomed to bringing gifts whenever we worship. And we know that in the earliest church, according to scripture, the gifts that people brought were the work of their hands, the bread that was made, the wheat that was grown, the grapes that were harvested, the wine that was poured. These were the gifts that were brought to the church as they celebrated together week after week the Lord's Supper. We don't, most of us in the big city, grow stuff. Some of us do, but mostly we get stuff from the grocery store and trust that it's good. But there are a lot of folks out there, and your church knows this, because you feed them every week. That is bringing your gifts to share when you support that. Understanding that there are folks that will get a hot, good meal because you care. That's all part of that network of giving. That's all part of that network, which is the kingdom of God. And so when we give, we are nurturing those blessings, not only for ourselves, but for others as well. Everything we do is so very important. So please remember to give.
Give from whom all blessings flow. Praise God, all creatures here below. Praise God above the heavens. Praise God, your sons and Holy Ghost.
Let us pray. Our Father who is in heaven, the earth is beautiful with the flowers of your love, caused to grow everywhere. We bring our tithes and offerings with love and joy to you. May they be used to show your love to people everywhere. Let your guiding hand lead us into the path of service to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Just talked about stuff that grows and what we receive from it. The bread, the cup, the vine, the bread. What a gift. What a gift. Even if we don't always understand exactly how it happens, we can trust God's love, God's presence. We can trust grace. And it is in this moment and in this celebration that we gather to remember how important that is for our lives. We remember that our Lord Jesus Christ, in celebrating God's love, gathered with his disciples around a table. And while they were eating, Jesus took bread. He blessed it and he broke it and he gave it to them. And he said, "This is my body and it's for you. As often as you eat this, remember me." And in the same way, he took a cup and he gave God thanksgiving. And he said, "In this is the blood of a new covenant, which is for you. As often as you share this meal, do it in remembrance of me."
Let us pray. God of grace, God of power, the heavens proclaim your faithfulness and all behold your glory. We come to your table acknowledging that the living Christ is Lord, our beginning and end. Help us to learn your love from this bread and cup, this bread which is broken for you, for us, just as the body of Jesus was broken. With this cup, we remember your life-giving love spilled out for us. Let this bread strengthen us and this cup help us to come to know Jesus and your love. We pray this in the communion meal. We will be reborn by your loving presence into the new life of your Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Will you join me in saying the Lord's Prayer together? Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Give us, as it is in heaven, give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.